ऑल
गोइंग लाइव।
राइट
या गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वी वेलकम यू ऑल टू ऑर्थो टीवी ऑनलाइन री लाइव सर्जरी सीरीज एंड टू इंट्रोड्यूस टुडे स्पीकर्स एंड द टॉपिक आई हैंड ओवर टू आवर मॉडरेटर डॉक्टर राजीव रमन।
Thank you, Neeraj, and thanks to Ortho TV for organizing this wonderful event of Relive Surgery. And today we have two eminent orthopedic surgeons from the western part, Dr. Vasudev Gadagone sir, and from the eastern part, Dr. Rajiv Chatterjee sir. And they will be demonstrating the Relive video series. Over to you, Rajiv da, for your first talk. And Vasudev sir.
आप स्टार्ट करो।
ओके ठीक है, आई शेयर स्क्रीन नाउ। ओके
यस, वी विल हैव बोथ द टॉक, देन वी विल हैव क्वेश्चन आंसर्स।
ओके, सो बेसिकली माय टॉक इज गोइंग टू बी ऑन अ फ्रैक्चर डिसलोकेशन, थ्री पार्ट फ्रैक्चर डिसलोकेशन, लेफ्ट शोल्डर सस्टेन्ड ऑन अ 56 ईयर ओल्ड राइट डोमिनेंट लेडी who the patient presented to us about 8 days down the line, usual shopping around. And what we'll do is take you, what we did on table, take us to the steps, videos of the steps that were important and how we went ahead fixing this slightly difficult fracture. I know for some people it's quite bread and butter stuff. For some of them can be really difficult to do. So let's look at what we can do to make this easier. So start off with, okay, so can you hear me now? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah,
you're audible. So this is a CT of a fracture dislocation. The head is dislocated down.
You can't see the
screen. Screen is not visible. Your presentation is not visible.
No, this is a video. I'm just presenting.
Or it's not visible.
Yeah.
I've done a screen share.
Now you start your video, make it a pause, then share it, Rajiv. That will be okay.
Started it and then
come back to Zoom.
Okay, hang on. Let's do this. Can you see me now?
Yeah, yep. Now,
can you
yeah,
see
now
me?
It.
Okay. You see it now?
Yes, yep. Now it's there.
Okay,
perfect.
So this is a fracture dislocation. The head is dislocated inferiorly. The lesser tuberosity is comminuted but still attached to the head. The CT scan, which I do routinely to sort of identify in the minds where the fragments are. It's a standard deltopectoral approach, supine position. Be very careful here initially. Just don't puncture the cephalic vein. Identify the, just cut the deltoid fascia. Looking for the, you know, my feel much more easier to work with. I don't go through the vein. The next bit after you have the important bit after you do the cephalic vein, in this case, especially go up it medial, identify the conjoint tendon because you might have to dig in to take the head out. So cephalic vein and the conjoint tendon both identified. So I got two landmarks identified and ready for me. Next, go for the biceps tendon. Identify the biceps tendon and come up because the biceps tendon will lead us to the rotator interval, which is the gap between the two tuberosities. Gradually tease out the biceps tendon. As you tease out the biceps tendon, you see the tuberosities are slowly coming into play. There's a greater tuberosity on top. And once you separate this out between the two tuberosities, using the rotator interval, you actually go straight down and look into the head. And you should be able to see the head lying in the axilla there. Look at the head is lying there. Put in a little Murphy's kid or whatever you want to gradually, gently lever the head up. Back into the glenoid, the head is nearly free floating. Try not to dissect out more soft tissue than has already been taken out. And once you slowly lever it out in the glenoid, you can use a KY not to pith it to the glenoid if you want to, if it's unstable. Check in AP and lateral. Okay, and this is what we are doing. Now we are holding the tuberosity fragment of the KY and then the head in position. So we are trying to put everything back into place. Once we have everything back in place, take the KYs out. And identify the tuberosity, which is actually dropped back in. So you need to, now that you've got head in position, now identify tuberosity, bring it up, and then put a wire from the top, the tuberosity, into the shaft, and one from the head into the glenoid. So you've got a top assembly ready now. The next bit is to get the soft tissues, which is the most, this is a soft tissue surgery. Get the attachment, the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, so the whatever muscle attached to greater tuberosity, assume the supraspinatus large mass, get a good thick 2 Vicryl in at the musculotendinous junction, one, pull on it, and you can put another one behind it. Once you have done that, you can clamp the two tuberosities together and see how the both tuberosities come together. So you have got the ties in. The next bit is to stabilize the tuberosity back in this place. So one more wire into the tuberosity, into the head, and you take out the top wire, which is the glenoid wire in, because that's going to get into the way of your plate. So now you have a tuberosity wire and two tuberosities wire. Now next you put a subscap stitch. This is the lesser tuberosity stitch, which actually holds the head and the lesser tuberosity together. There, I'm pulling the head. So you have two stitches on the greater tuberosity, one stitch on the lesser tuberosity. Once your stitch is in place, and one wire from the tuberosity into the head and one from the top into the shaft, you have a reasonable assembly. Now get your ELOS plate. Here I use the top of the plate is where the tuberosity ends. It actually just conforms on because the reduction has been done. Now get your plate on, put a wire through the anterior hole, just to get it centralized in the head. Once you're there, you can move the plate as you want. The next very important bit is get the sutures through the suture holes. It has happened where in my enthusiasm, I've forgotten to take the sutures, because once you put the screws in, you can't put the sutures in. So why put the wire in before the suture is because the wire will stabilize the plate onto the humerus. So it's easier to put the sutures in. Once you've got all the sutures through the suture holes, your first hole is the oblong hole. Where you need to put a screw through the oblong, so you can push your plate up and down if you want. So here we have got a screw in the oblong hole, and the height looks reasonable. How do we know reasonable? It's just below the head of the humerus and lateral view, it's on the tuberosity, just kissing the tuberosity. To prevent the helicopter effect, put the second screw, because otherwise the phyllos plate might swing up and down. So put the second screw also in the plate. Don't tighten them completely, just hold them loosely. Now you come on top, tighten the top screw, and let the plate sit on the bone. Tie off all the sutures now, because otherwise the drill bit can wrap around the sutures and tear the sutures. So now we have done the soft tissue procedure, the bottom of the bony procedure, which we are holding the fracture together. The next bit is to fill the top, the head part with screws. This is where now we bring the jig in. I don't put the jig in at first because it becomes too cumbersome otherwise. The important bit why we do the jig now is otherwise the screw trajectory can change. You try putting in without the jig, quite often you get cross-threading and the screws don't go in well. So you have the jig, the screws go in the proper direction. The important screws are the top two screws and the bottom screws and the one middle screw. You have to have at least 5 screws in the head, if not 6 screws. So most two important screws are in repeating. The top two screws, the middle one, back to front screw, and the climbing screws, at least 2 if possible. The screws that you put in, if you're going with power, remember the last bit is by hand. So you put by power, remember stop, because soft bone, the power might just lock the, so you get a cylindrical hole. So start with power, go into hand. So take all the wires out and check in AP and lateral. Make sure none of the screws, these are multi-axial screws. What looks good on AP might look bad on lateral. Look and see what happens in this case. The AP looks good. Now it will have a lateral view here. You see that one of the screws is poking out. The calcaneus screw is poking out. So you just take the screw out. That wasn't as of the, so just take it out. Because I've got 2 calcaneus screws in. So make sure in AP and transaxial lateral, all the screws in the head, make sure moving up and down the shoulder. Close the deltoid fascia, close the skin, and this is as the head and the shaft would look. Immediate mobilization. Thank you. I said stop sharing now.
Thank you, Rajiv. Rajivda, it was a wonderful full presentation. I think now I have to invite Dr. Vasudev Gadugone, sir. He will be speaking on nailing technique in fracture set of clavicle. And then we will have a question from you too.
Okay, is it seen?
Yes.
Yes, sir. You're audible and it's visible.
So, displaced mid-clavicular fracture, nailing is the best option. Non-operative treatment, most of the shaft fractures, clavicle will heal by conservative treatment. Conclusion of Mackey and study, displaced mid-clavicular fracture can cause significant persistent disability even if they heal uneventfully. Malunion and non-union 15 to 20% and there is a considerable shoulder dysfunction. So fracture clavicle midarter is still a virgin area in the orthopedics for surgical treatment. What literature says on displaced mid-clavicular fracture, indications are displaced greater than 2 centimeter displacement, greater than 2 centimeter overlapping, comminuted fracture and skin compromise, and if there are neurovascular structures are involved and in a compound fracture, fixation is indicated. Majority of the cases can be treated by the conservative treatment, but there is a place for operative treatment. Fracture clavicle middle third, plate or nail. There is always a dilemma amongst the many workers and surgeons also, whether to do a plating or nailing. Plate is a open method. It is invasive surgery. X-ray looks very good. There are so many complications, but there are new anatomical plates. They restore the anatomy and the option is very attractive. Nailing is a minimal invasive treatment of mid-shaft clavicular fracture using titanium elastic nails. Now they are available freely and people are now started doing all by titanium elastic nails. But there is a major disadvantage of this nail is because they are not locking nail. Therefore, if there is a fracture settlement, you find that there is a migration of the nails and you will find that the nail has protruded out of the skin. That is the major disadvantage. So in a comminuted third fracture, all fractures cannot be, we cannot apply the rule that everything, every fracture should be treated by conservative or operative. We have to think whether to operate on this patient, the occupation policeman. He wants to go on duty for a very early, whether to operate or conserve. Patient history to understand his or her activity level, functional demands and expectation. That is the most important thing. And one must suggest to the patient whether you need a surgery or you need a conservative treatment with you have to wear a cuff and collar or a clavicle brace for a longer time, but it gives the same results. So in a comminuted third fracture, 34-year policeman, earlier return to work, I did a close intramedullary nailing, was done. This also can be treated by a plating anatomical. So depends on the occupation of the patient, we need to do a surgery and the patient's decision is also a more important rather than the surgeon's possible indication. So comminuted middle third fracture, perfect healing and restoration of the function. So intramedullary fixation, there are so many devices are used nowadays, large threaded cannulated screws, Rockwood pins, flexible elastic nails, interlock nails are also now available. And I use a screw intramedullary nail, which is already, this paper is published in March 2018 in Indian Journal of Orthopedic. Now I have must have done more than 100 cases. This is the report that I am aware. 30 cases with very, very gratifying result, and that I am going to describe now on video. So this is the displaced midshaft clavicular fracture. This is the position. There should be a bump under the skin, scapula, under skeleton block. You can do this surgery, no need of giving the general anesthesia. Before you plan a surgery, you must assess the displacement as well as the medullary canal. That is the most, whether it is osteoporotic bone or it is a where there is a canal or not. If the canal is very small, then or narrow, it is very difficult to pass a nail, and less than 2 mm nail will not serve purpose. Such a patient should be operated for or given a chance for plating. Now this is the surface marking of the fracture clavicle. You can see here I use a medial incision. This is the screw nail which I use. There are various sizes. Mostly in the clavicle, it is 2.5 is required. In a some osteoporotic bone, when there is a canal is wide, you can use a 3 mm and you have to bend the tip of the nail so that it smoothly goes inside the medullary canal. I preferably ream the canal with the flexible reamers. There are 2.5, 2 mm reamers are available. You can use a 4-arm reamers also. This is a curved awl, straight awl, so that, and it should not be up a very long, because otherwise you may injure the unsaid pleura. Most important, you can use a towel clips also for reduction purpose. These are the instruments are required for the clavicular nailing. And this is the marking you can see here on the soft bone of the medial end of the clavicle. And you can see that is the only portion which is a it is soft bone, that is a cancellous bone where you can introduce a nail and all. They give a small incision near about 1 centimeter with a pointed knife and then go reach to the bone. And with a curved awl, first with the straight awl and then with the curved awl, you have to go to the clavicle. It is very easy to pass, but you have to be have a firm hold over the awl, otherwise it may go inside and you may puncture the pleura. That will be a most dangerous thing to do it. So after doing this with the canal finder with this, and then this is the and you have to do assess the canal and reaming. That is most important because the clavicle is a curved bone. It is very difficult to pass a straight nail, so you have to ream it. And then with the help of that lever arm of the reamer and holding with the towel clip, the distal fragment, you bring the fracture fragment together and then just negotiate the reamer, and you will find, you will feel that whether the this reamer is inside or not. Because that is also, we have to ream it a distal part also. Otherwise, you may land into the trouble and you may perforate the clavicle. Now, by to and fro movement, slowly pass the screw nail, and across the fracture site, we have to be very careful. You will get a feel that it has gone inside, and we have to see both the views. In 30 degree caudal as well as cephalad and AAP view, and then after pushing inside with this, you can give small blows, and then again you can do a screwing of the nail, and you can see it is going inside. You cannot, and it will plug into that a solid flat portion of the distal clavicle and the sitting of the screw inside the metaphysis of the medial end in the cancellous bone, so that there will be no protrusion of that screw, and 2-3 threads are to be kept outside so that while removing it, you can identify. This is a very small incision. It's a close technique. If you are not able to find are able to reduce it, don't hesitate to give a small incision. Try 2-3 times. If the reduction comes, give a small incision of near about 2 centimeter. Find the ends, clamp with the forearm clamp, and then you can pass the nail and they complete the procedure as you have done previously. We have to see the exact length of the nail, otherwise you may get a perforation. It's a very small incision. You can see 2-stage surgery even after doing a open surgery, and it is in the flat. The nail end should be buried in the flat bone so that there will not be any protrusion of the on the distal end. So this is how the post-op X-ray you can see in the AP and the cephaloid view. It is perfectly nicely fitting. Just forget about that anatomical reduction is not necessary because healing of the clavicle is not an issue at all. So these are the clavicle is the is this is this okay. So this is how we have to do the surgery. Now this is a minimal invasive surgery. You can see I will give 2-3 examples. This is a comminuted butterfly fragment is there, done by a closed method, perfect anatomical reduction, and you can see here a stitchless surgery. But that does not happen always. You have to give sometime a open reduction. 30% of the cases it requires, and it requires a very good precision while passing the nail into the opposite distal end. And we have also to see the neurovascular bundle anatomy is the most important to observe. This is how it is. If you have a difficulty, this is the displaced fracture. I did entry point marker, everything, but I failed to do a close reduction. I gone up to this level, difficult to for this for me because I have started with the close method. Then I did a small incision, open reduction, and then the negotiation of the nail. So it is not always a close procedure. You may sometime have to give a small incision to identify the fragments because there is maybe some soft tissue intervention and probably will not be able to get reduction. Most it occurs in the spiral fractures, and in a transverse fracture it is sometimes difficult. So this is the X-ray displacement clavicular fracture, and you can see a perfect anatomical restoration. Though people say that it doesn't work in a comminuted, yes, it works because there is only 3-point fixation. One fixation in the cancellous bone, other being the flat bone of the distal end clavicle, and it's a curved bone. Therefore, it gives a 3-point fixation, and it can work in the comminuted fracture. And at all, there is some settling and shortening that does not go more than 5 mm, which does not geopardize the function. Another example, a segmental fracture. Screw intramedullary nail was done. There was a bone fragment was popping out here, and it came late. And you can see here the nail has fixed both the fractures, and patient had gone into the. And you can see a perfect anatomical restoration, and patient had a full function. Clavicle malunion also you can do. This is how it is. It's not acceptable cosmetically. It is not a good thing. It's okay in the old age, but in the young age, if you get a bump like this, it's not good because you cannot carry this bump throughout the life, and it will be a problem of the skin. So initially treated with the strengthening, especially of scapulothoracic stabilizer, because there is always a dysfunction of the shoulder after the malunion. Therefore, you must have some physiotherapy session. And if there is no relief and patient wants a correction, better to go ahead with the nailing or plating. So relative indication, it's not an absolute indication. Open reduction and fixation by screw intramural nailing, 3 months follow up, the perfect anatomy and patient restore the function. And you can see, this is the, after 2 years of follow up, very, very good callus formation, and patient had a 1 year follow up full function with complete anatomical restoration and secondary callus forms. Such a grossly displaced clavicle fracture with the punctured wound, You just cannot apply a brace also, and with the protruding, this is the punctured wound. It is very difficult for the patient to get a conservative treatment, debridement of the wound, reduction and screw intramedullary nail, wound healed, fracture also healed very well, and you can say minimal invasive treatment. He is working in a bank, went to office within 3 weeks without any problem, and you can see here there is a restoration of even the clavicle curve. It is mostly said that there is a loss of some curvature of the clavicle. Yes, some loss of curvature may occur, but it does not hamper the functional outcome. Another example, a displaced comminuted fracture. I did the close intramedullary nailing, kept all the fragments comminuted like that only, and you can see healing by callus formation and complete remodeling of the clavicle in 1 year follow. So I can share innumerable x-rays, but there is another problem where there is an osteoporotic bone and patient is a very old man. You can see protruding clavicle. In a such a situation, if you pass a single nail up a 3 mm also, it does not hold good. In that case, you may use a stack nailing in the clavicle bone also, so that you must have stability must be achieved so that the patient can work with that particular hand. So plate is a better in a comminuted and non-united fracture and nail in a transverse and less comminuted fracture. This is the literature says. But I assure you, if you do it properly, you can also get a good result in a comminuted fractures. Plate or nail is not immune to complication. That is also most important. And take home message, indication of open reduction and internal fixation of displaced midclavicular fracture has been now defined. Consistent achievement of union and low frequency of complications with operative treatment. Conservative care results in around 15% of non-union and symptomatic malunion in 33%, which was not studied in a previous study. No difference between nails and plates in terms of healing and functional outcome. Therefore, it is your choice whether to do a nailing or plating, and always we have to choose between the two, minimal invasive surgery with mostly a scarless surgery or a open surgery with a very large scar and injury to the supraclavicular nerves, which are a very troublesome job if the neuroma formation is there. So therefore, it depends on the surgeon's choice as well as the patient choice. And majority of these patients, they can be treated with the conservative treatment, but I opt for the clavicle nailing in a most displaced fractures and overriding of more than 2 cm for nailing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Please stop sharing your screen. One question for for Rajiv Chatterjee, sir. So deltopectoral, deltoid splitting. So how do you decide?
I mean, this is a fracture dislocation. This is impossible to do with the deltoid split. If it's a two-part simple fracture, a bit displaced, I would do a deltoid split. But my 80% of the job is through a deltopectoral, because unfortunately, the ones that I get are usually 3 or 4 part with dislocations, which cannot be done through a deltoid.
Rajiv ji, one of the question, if there are the posteriorly displaced humeral head, some posteriorly displaced humeral head, sometimes it is very difficult to bring it out by the deltopectoral approach. Then
I've got a case series of 6 delayed, more than 4 month old posterior fracture dislocations. All 6 have got them out from the front. You have to be patient. What you do is go through the rotator interval, open it out completely, get the shaft, actually skeletonize the shaft, take the shaft out. You actually look into the head lying posteriorly, and then you put a threaded Steinman pin into it and another K wire, gradually jiggle it out. I've got a series of about 6 cases which I have done, and all 6 cases I presented in China actually. In one, I had to give a posterior incision, one small to push it, but all five came out. You have to just use a rotator interval and scanterize the shot.
I have seen in your video, yeah. You pass a K-wire through the glenoid. You put the head with the glenoid.
Yeah, initially, because this is a nearly a free floating fragment, once you put it in, the head is hardly has any attachments at all. So you put it to the glenoid, hold it, and then remove it before putting the plate in. Once you get it, because it's like building a Lego brick, it's a Lego thing. So you first get the head in the glenoid, then put the tuberosity on top, then get the tuberosity, the lesser tuberosity on top, get them together, then take the glenoid.
So this is for all cases, or you do it when it's a very small fragment or neglected fracture dislocation?
Which one?
Fixing of the humeral head with the glenoid.
If it's a dislocated head, I would, once I reduce it, does not have a, they usually don't have any attachment at all, literally. So I always, if it's dislocated inferiorly, when you bring it up, put one wire and take it out before you put the plate on.
How you judge the rotation of the head when there is a four-part fracture? The head part is different, GT, LT shaft are different, and the head is small now, and only articular surface. And how you judge the rotation of the humeral head?
There you are on the side of retroversion. So you just make sure the head is aligned to the glenoid. So that is where the glenoid wire comes in. So I see it. So you use a rotator interval, open it out, see the head sitting there, make the head align to the glenoid, and then drop the shaft on top of it. And if you want to err on the side of retroversion rather than antiversion.
Okay. And what is your criteria for going for replacement primarily in case such cases?
So, rather than fixing? A very excellent question. I was just waiting for it. So that is the reason I got a CT scan. Okay. About 4 or 5 years ago, twice happened in succession. I said, come on, there's nothing, I'll fix it. Oh, 3 hours, I'll do it. Opened it out. After 4 hours, I was looking for a replacement. Everything was in my hand. I didn't do a CT. So 4 years ago, from now on, anywhere where I can't describe a fracture, I'll get a CT done. So even if the patient cannot pay for it, I tell them to do the cranial CT, one film. I just said, let me find out how many fragments the head is. I don't want anything else. So if the head is splintered, if the head is split, and if it's an elderly patient more than 50, I would replace it. If it is a less than 50, still I would tell him that AVN, because advantage with AVN is in the shoulder is less symptomatic. I would still go ahead, I'd keep headless screws, reconstruct the head, and get something in there so that even if AVN happens, you can still get, I have one Panwala in Krishnagar, whom I've done, who's got AVN, 12 years ago I've done it. So AVN, he refuses any surgery. He says, I'm fine. He makes fun, he's happy.
Okay.
Luckily, and because it's a non-weight-bearing zone.
Non-weight-bearing, yeah. And
if patient is affordable, I put the evolutus stem in, which is HA-coated. Okay. Because there I can, at any point of time, switch into a reverse. I keep a reverse handy. Because if the tuberosity is completely shattered, I'm talking of the elderly 65, 70-year-old where everything is smashed. So I would keep a reverse ready. But if it's a 55, so I divide my patients into three bits, head split fracture, less than 50, 50 to 65, 65, 70 onwards. So less than 50, I will somehow get them together. I will not replace. I'll tell them, AVN, let it happen. 5-10 years down the line, I will replace it. 50 to 70, I would try my utter best to do a simple hemi, if possible, with the evolutive shoulder, wherein after 10, 15 years, if it fails, I can just take the top off and go to a reverse. More than 70, I would keep a reverse in.
Okay. One more question. According to your experience, the cases when you are doing primary hemi and where fracture has united, but it has collapsed or AVN or something like that, and then you have done a hemi. The postoperative range of movement or any complication is good in which cases?
Very good question. Primary hemi is always better. Always better. Primary hemi is always better. When you do them secondarily, they hardly get, I know there are some people get fantastic motion. My patients do not get more than 100. This is a maximum. I tell them, bhaiya, baal jhaad lena, If you are male, you can shave. If a woman, you will do a trick movement. I tell, show them that you will tie your hair like okay. that. You can't do this, uh-huh. tie your hair. And say them, aapka andaruni jo pehna padega, waha saamne wala pita wala andaruni pehna padega. So wearing the bra from the top. I tell them, because they will not get more than 100 if I do them secondarily. I don't get them. However good I do them. The only problem I have with a hemi or a shoulder replacement, my being a trauma surgeon primarily, my heart bleeds when I have to replace them. So I would like to fix.
Yeah, because many of the people, they say that the tuberosity in replacement, the chances that the tuberosity are getting united to the shaft is little bit difficult. Then when you do primary fixation, let them unite and then go for hemi if the patient is having problem.
Because even if you look at the AO manual and the studies and my own experience, when you do them secondarily, they are so scarred down. The tuberosities are scarred down.
Absolutely.
I mean, why did I do it? Why do I have to do it? Because the implant is cut through or the tuberosities run off. Once the tumors run off, I'm looking at a reverse. I'm not looking at, if I'm doing a manifa division, is the last two I've done. I'm telling you, last two I've done, the last 2 years, I've 1.5 years done only two. And all both okay. reverse. Both are reverse. I could not do a primary.
Okay.
And I couldn't identify anything.
Sorry?
I could not identify anything.
Okay. And what is your implant choice between a Philos type of plate and the newer plate anatomical, which are holding the posterior beak or?
You're talking periarticular plate.
Periarticular.
Both have been drawn.
Are they having different indications?
Yeah, I mean, if a fracture, the one that we had showed where there's a head there, I need the head to be stabilized. The problem with the periarticular plate is does not have those lovely climbing screws. The calcar screw is what is the most important fixing tool. That is the reason I put a Philos or a Philos type implant, which is my primary implant. The one case where I would do a periarticular plate would be a tuberosity fracture with an undisplaced two-part fracture. But I'm using a buttress plate. Otherwise, my use in a periarticular is two in the last 3 years.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Rajita. Gadugane, sir, there's a question on here. So when do you decide that sometime it has happened because of the narrow canal, you have decided that no, in spite of nailing, I have to convert it into plating?
Because we have to judge first. If you are not able to negotiate the nail, and the canal is narrow, just straight away convert into the anatomical plating. And whenever you do a nailing, we should be ready for three things. One, I may not get a closure reduction. I may require an open reduction. Second, and I may require a conversion to plating operation also. So it's not a very rigid thing that I will do nailing. So very expert people, they can do it. I have not converted till date, but it is always mandatory to keep. When you go for a surgery, both the ornamentarium plate as well as the nail. But and if there is a canal is narrow, very, and if you are not able to pass even a 2 mm nail, then you don't do it. Because that 2 mm elastic wires will not be able to sustain the load of your shoulder girdle. So there will be again a malunion or there will be a breakage or something like that. So it is better not to do. At least you must have a 2.5 to 3 mm. 2.5 is the optimum.
Can I ask you, sir?
Yes.
Sir, when you do the distal fixation, which is, you know, near the acromion, is there any point that you have to hit and otherwise you're not happy? How close to the acromion do you need to get?
Actually, 2 cm part is that it's solid. The distal to it and it's a flat. So your nail tip should go into that flat portion. It should not be in the canal like it. Otherwise, you will get a migration here and there.
Yeah.
So if you want to have a 3-point fixation, it must hit the cortex. One of the cortex in the distal, maybe in the middle or maybe in the end, anterior or posterior. So hitting up that particular nail tip at the solid portion is the most important thing. If you keep it only in the canal, what will happen? There will be some problem. It will not be very.
Is it beveled at the edge so that it goes into the flat bit at the end?
Yes, it is a beveled edge.
Fantastic, fantastic.
And what is
what
the time?
Okay, yeah, Raju sir, go.
Yeah, please, Sapni sir, please. Yeah,
Gadevare sir, what is the post-op protocol? I mean, you put a sling or something like that, and for how many days and when you start mobilizing?
I start immediate mobilization for protection only. I keep it for 3 weeks because it does not matter very much. You are testing everywhere. So the sling or brace, it does not matter for the patient satisfaction. For at least 10 to 15 days, we give brace and then ask them to have a protected the shoulder movements. So, and after 1 month, he can do anything. Patient, they are very happy and they start doing everything after 1 month. There is no problem. So after 1 month, you take the x-ray. If everything goes normal, then continue. Healing will occur and then you recover also the patient. They come after 6 months, 9 months, and it's like that.
And you remove the implant under local anesthesia or you need again a block?
Under local anesthesia, but very few people they demand for removal. Only if there is just some protrusion or something like that. After doing so many cases, at least I have must have removed 3 or 4, that's all. So majority they don't come for removal.
Okay.
एक बार सर्जरी करवा लेते हैं उसके बाद आप वापस
आ नहीं नहीं कुछ जरूरत नहीं है हां
सो फॉर रिमूवल आई मीन हाउ डू यू रिमूव डज द बिकॉज यू नो वी यूज द स्क्रूड्राइवर
देयर इज ऑलरेडी 2-3 सीरेशंस वी कूप आउट सो यू गिव ए इंसिजन एंड डिग इट आउट अराउंड दैट विद द स्क्रू एंड ट्राई टू पुश इट इनसाइड दैट स्क्रू एंड जस्ट रोटेट इट हियर एंड देयर यू विल गेट इट आउट देयर इज नो प्रॉब्लम But if there is a longer period of time, more than 1 year or more than 1.5 years, the osteointegration around that screw will occur and probably you will have a difficulty, then you will have to dig it out more and more. Mm-hmm. So if you want to remove this nail, it is better to ask them that 9 months ke baad aa jaiye bhaiya aur nikal lo. Or otherwise, rehne dijiye.
Nope. Nope. We are using routine L wires. Or small flexible nails, and we are keeping here in bend around more than 90 degree bend, and we just keep it under the skin. The biggest disadvantage compared to your nail is, in some people it is little proud. There are skin irritation, and some people only they are having cosmetically there is a proud. So we usually remove them around 3 to 5 months period. Under local anesthesia, just take the incision and just leave it out.
That is good option. That is also actually healing is no problem in clavicle if you don't indulge into that particular thing.
Absolutely.
Only you have to keep it for at least 3 months. Also, it's okay. And if you remove it, also everything will heal up. It is only in the plating.
Yes.
Though it looks very good, but it takes longer time for healing.
The amount of devascularization
and also the chances of refracture are very high.
Yeah, because the amount of combination that if this combination, you put a plate on, don't know what holds where. There's no anatomy there. It's always very difficult to even with anatomy because anatomical plates are made for the Western anatomy. They quite often don't. There's no.
They doesn't.
They are not. They don't fit inside there.
Absolutely.
And there is another problem is that there is a scar. If there is a keloid formation, then it's a very bad thing.
And you can feel the plate.
And there is another problem is that if you there is always injury. Though they say plater, we preserve that supraclavicular nerve. I don't find because I have done number of them also. It is very difficult to preserve supraclavicular nerve.
Never.
Dissection, it is only for demonstration, it's good. But in practice, I don't think everybody is dissecting that 4-5 minutes.
The good thing is very cosmetic, especially for female patients. Female patients, nailing is very cosmetic.
Absolutely.
I think we don't have any question on YouTube.
And even the results are same.
Results are same. But only the radiological picture looks very attractive in plating. That is the only because you are only stabilizing the fracture by nail. So there is just some translation of 2 mm here and there. So it doesn't look very nice for at least 1 or 2 months. And then after 3 months, you will find that everything is come.
Yes.
I think we don't have any question on YouTube.
No.
Thank you, Gadugane sir. Thank you, Rajiv da, for wonderful real life video series. And we would like to have a vote of thanks from our moderator, Dr. Swapnil.
Please. This is a short but sweet program.
Yeah, so we try to keep it less than 1 hour now. Webinar for less than 1 hour.
That is good thing. On Sunday, there is a program of Tandak. It is for more than 3 hours.
Yeah. Swapnil sir, please. For vote of thanks.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Gade Gunes sir and Raju sir. Sorry, I joined little late, and I'm 100% sure that the presentation of Raju sir has to be, I mean, it would have been very excellent. And I saw Gade Gunes sir's presentation, clavicle patient, at least 3 to 4 times. And it's really amazing implant what he has showed. And I really thank both of the speakers to have taken a time from their busy schedule. I also thank Raju sir and Neeraj sir for taking time for this real life session. Thanks a lot, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Neeraj was not there, I think. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Raju sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Gadugane sir. Thank you, Raju sir. Good night.
Yeah. Good night, sir. Thanks.